Almighty God will send help to you from heaven.
I discovered that I could not see a gate. On that holy communion, I poured in it wine into my hand. I am here tonight.
Anyone trying to transfer with God's pleasure for your life shall be frustrated.
stone.
Thank you. I've been
bless the King of Kings. Let's bless the Lord of Lords. Let's worship the Ancient of Days. Let's give him glory. Let's give him honor. Let's give him adoration. Lift him high. He's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be adored. He's worthy to be magnified. Lift him high. Let him hear your voice. Praise him. Give him glory. Give him honor. Give him adoration. Bless the King of Kings. Bless the Lord of Lords. Bless the Ancient of Days. Magnify his holy name. Magnify his holy name. Thank you, my Father. You're worthy to be praised. You're worthy to be adored. Oh, Lord God Almighty, there's no one like you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Almighty. Thank you, Savior. Thank you, Almighty God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Lift your voice to the Almighty God and say, Father, tonight, from the face of any of us, wipe away all tears. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty. From the face of any of us, wipe away all tears, Lord. Wipe away all tears. From the face of the young, from the face of the old, from the face of men and women, boys and girls, wipe away all tears. Almighty God, wipe away all tears. Thank you, Father. Glory be to God. Wipe away all tears and just let your name be glorified as a result. Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Worthy, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy, worthy. Worthy, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Amen. Glory, alleluia. Glory, alleluia. Glory, alleluia. Glory, alleluia. King of kings, you are worthy. Lord of lords, you are worthy. Ancient of days, you are worthy. The unchangeable changer, you are worthy. Accept our worship in Jesus' name. Thank you for what you did on Monday. Thank you for what you did on Tuesday. Thank you for what you did yesterday. Thank you for what you are about to do now. Thank you for what you will do tomorrow. Please accept our worship in Jesus' name. Almighty God, we have come to you tonight expecting the flood of joy. Please, my Father and my God, even now as we pray, wipe away tears from all our eyes. Release the flood of joy to us tonight. And at the end of everything, let your name be glorified. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Hey, someone shout hallelujah. Well, shake hands with two or three people and tell them, God will cause you to laugh. And then you may please be seated. John 16, verse 24. Hitherto have ye asked nothing in my name. Ask, and ye shall receive, that your joy may be full. The joy of somebody is going to be full tonight. And I like the passage very well because you have been praying since Monday, and I appreciate you. I'm encouraged by the way you had prayed since the beginning of this week. But now the Lord himself is saying, up to now, you haven't even prayed the way you should pray. He said you should pray, you should keep on asking till your joy be full. Tonight, someone will go home with fullness of joy. There is abundant joy in heaven. Psalm 16, verse 11. Psalm 16, verse 11 says, in the presence of the Almighty God, there is fullness of joy. And in heaven, God is always at hand to wipe away tears. Revelation chapter 7, verse 17. Revelation 7, verse 17. He says, God will wipe away all tears from their eyes. You say, well, if heaven is full of joy, how come some people are crying? We don't want to go into the theology of that now. But one thing is this. Because I asked that question from my daddy a long time ago. He said, when we get to heaven, every one of us will cry. First of all, we'll cry for joy that we have made it. How many of you will make it? I will see you there in Jesus' name. And then everybody will cry when they begin to test your work. Because the Bible says it is fire that will test your work. So when you see fire doing its terrible work on the work you have done on earth, to see how much of it will remain, you will cry. And then you will cry when they begin to reward you for the work you have done. You will wish that you had done much more. The opportunities to serve God that you allow to slip through your hand, because they will reveal everything to us.
I will show you day by day opportunity to give, opportunity to witness, opportunity to help, opportunity to do things for God that you allow to sleep. And then they will show you what would have been your reward. And they will still give you a reward for the little you have done. You will cry. But the Bible says, God will say, don't cry. After all, you are here. It will wipe away the tears. That's why I'm believing God for someone tonight, that God will wipe away your tears. Now, let's start by looking at the opposite of joy. It's something called sorrow. And if there's anything at all we learn from the scriptures, it is that sorrow is a killer. Sorrow is what? A killer. Say it loud and clear. So you need to understand that. Everything that the Bible says about sorrow is bad. Sorrow dims vision. In Job chapter 17, verse 7, Job 17, verse 7, Job said, my eyes are dim because of sorrow. So when somebody is sad, the vision becomes dim. And the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18, Proverbs 29, verse 18, when there is no vision, the people perish. So sorrow can dim vision, and dimming the vision can lead to perishing. And then Proverbs chapter 15, verse 13, Proverbs 15, verse 13, tells us that sorrow breaks the spirit of man. It breaks the spirit of man. And then in Proverbs 17, verse 22, Proverbs 17, verse 22, just to give you some Bible passages concerning sorrow. The Bible says, a merry heart draweth good like medicine, but a broken spirit, who can bear? Sorrow breaks spirit, and a broken spirit is a very difficult thing to bear. A wounded spirit, who can bear? So we find that sorrow puts a man in grave danger. It can destroy man. It can destroy a man physically. It can destroy a man mentally. It can destroy a man spiritually. I mean, a great man like Elijah, in 1 Kings chapter 19, if you read it from verse 1 to 4, 1 Kings 19, verse 1 to 4, the same man who had called down fire from heaven just some hours before, when something happened that caused him sorrow, he asked God to kill him. Sorrow is a killer. And I'll give you just one illustration before we pray our first prayer. There was a woman in one of the islands in River State years ago. Early in the morning, she will wake up, take a little calabash, go to the beach, and with that little calabash, she will begin to bail water out of the ocean from morning to evening. What are you doing? Why are you trying to bail water out of the ocean? I want to bail the water out. What happened? She had an only son. The son went abroad to study, qualified, was coming back to Nigeria, came to Apapa Wharf. In those days, they traveled by boat. boy was coming down the steps of the boat. He saw the mother in excitement. Ha, mama, ha, my son. He slipped, fell into the ocean, and they never found his body. So the woman was bailing out the water, looking for her son. Stand on your feet. Join your hand with your neighbor. Lift your voice to the Most High God and say, Father, we are in agreement. No more sorrow. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty God. No more sorrow in our lives. No more sorrow in our homes. No more sorrow in our families. No more sorrow in our churches. No more sorrow, oh Lord. No more sorrow. We are all in agreement, Daddy. No more sorrow. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, no more sorrow. No more sorrow. No more sorrow. No more sorrow. Father, no more sorrow, no more sorrow, no more sorrow. Thank you, Father. We are in agreement, Daddy, all of us, in one accord. We agree, Daddy, no more sorrow, no more sorrow, in the mighty name of Jesus, no more sorrow, no more sorrow, no more sorrow, Lord God Almighty, no more sorrow. No more sorrow. No more sorrow. No more sorrow. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. And so shall it be in Jesus' name. Please, before you sit down, prophesy to your neighbor and say, you shall weep no more. And then you may please be seated. Thank you, Father. Now, what is joy? Joy is the opposite of sorrow. And the purpose of God for you is to have joy all the time. He wants you to have joy all the time. But because of time, joy can be in categories. There is ordinary joy, just joy. And then there is what the Bible calls great joy. And when you search through the scriptures, you discover that great joy comes as the joy of restoration. When opportunities that you think have been lost forever are suddenly restored, what you have is not ordinary joy, but great joy. For example, 2 Samuel chapter 6, from verse 12 to 15, 2 Samuel 6, you can read it from verse 1 to 15 when you get to. David went to get the Ark of the Covenant of God. He was bringing the Ark into the city. On the way, there was an accident and somebody died. And David said, no, I can't take this Ark into my city. I didn't know it's so deadly. Let's take the Ark to the house of Obed-Edom. If he dies, let him die. So they took the ark to the house of Obed-Edom, and the Almighty God began to bless Obed-Edom like nobody's business. So much that within 3 months, the whole nation began to talk about Obededo. And then somebody came and told David, the fellow you thought was going to die, God is blessing him beyond measure. David said, is that so? They said, yes, I'm going to get the ark. When finally he got the ark back, the Bible said he came into the city singing, dancing, leaping, even though he was a king, but he was full of great joy. Joy of restoration. Or in Acts chapter 3, verse 1 to 8, Acts 3, verse 1 to 8, tells you the story of the man who was born lame. He thought he was going to live and die a layman. He never thought that he would be able to walk. But one day, the Almighty God paid him a visit. And I know God is going to pay somebody a visit tonight. So when he found himself on his two legs, he wasn't just walking. The Bible says he was walking and leaping and praising God. He didn't have ordinary joy. He had great joy. Or you can take the case of Sarah, who thought at 90 it was, let's forget about children. And then all of a sudden, God paid her a visit. And the sorrow of 90 years was changed to laughter. When she gave birth to Isaac, she named him Laughter, so that he can keep on laughing. Joy of restoration. It happened in London. Some of you have heard the testimony at the Holy Ghost service there. They call it Festival of Life. A woman came from America to visit her sisters. She had been barren all her life. It was a long time she menstruated last. And suddenly the word of God came. And the word is coming to somebody tonight. God said that there was someone there that God has reduced her years by 10. She said it must be me. So she turned to her sisters and said, hey, don't call me auntie anymore. I'm 10 years younger now, so I'm younger than some of you. Almost immediately, the word of God came again that there was someone here that thought she can never have a child. God says you are going to have your own. Ah. He said, oh God, I didn't know that they called the program just because of me. A year later, she came back with her baby. She didn't have ordinary joy. She had great joy. Stand on your feet. I want you to join your hands with your neighbor. Lift your voice to the Almighty God and say, Father, every opportunity that I have lost, restore tonight. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty God. Every opportunity that I have lost in my life, restore tonight. Reverse the irreversible. Reverse the irreversible. Every opportunity I have lost, restore. Restore to me, Lord, so that I can have a taste of great joy. Restore to me. Restore to me every opportunity I have lost. Restore to me tonight so I can have great joy. I don't want just ordinary joy, I want great joy. So every opportunity I've lost, restore to me, Lord. Restore to my neighbor. Restore, oh Lord, restore. 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 Thank you, Father. Thank you, Almighty. And so shall it be in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. So the Bible says there is joy. There is great joy. And then there is what the Bible calls exceeding great joy. That is joy that is greater than great. Exceeding great joy. Now, according to the Bible, this is the joy you have when you finally reach your goal. And I'm decreeing tonight to somebody here, you will reach your goal. Because in Matthew chapter 2, from verse 1 to 10, Matthew 2, verse 1 to 10. Oh, thank you, Father. Daddy says I should tell someone that it took him only one night to free a whole nation. He said, tonight I will free your entire family. In Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 to 10, the Bible tells us the story of the wise men. They were coming to see Jesus. Bible scholars said they traveled for 2 years before they finally arrived. They said they knew it was 2 years because when Herod was going to say they should kill children, he said they should kill children who are 2 years and under. They've been traveling for 2 years. Finally, they got to where Jesus was. And the Bible said, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. In the name that's above every other name, by the time you get home, your joy will be exceeding great joy. Reaching your goal might not sound to some people as big, but if the journey had been saturated with all manners of obstacles, when you finally arrive, surely your joy will be exceeding great joy. When you get home, study 1 Samuel chapter 17 again. 1 Samuel chapter 17, you can read it all the way from verse 1 to 52. It's the story of David and Goliath that we are all very familiar with. David has just been anointed to be king in 1 Samuel 16. The moment the devil knew this boy is to be king, he raised up all manners of enemies to make sure he won't get there. First, he sent a lion. Then he sent a bear. And when he discovered that the boy killed those two, he decided to send Goliath. Just listen to what Goliath said. He said, I'm a soldier. You people find somebody to come and fight me. If I win, the kingdom of Israel becomes our own. as the kingdom meant for David. If I lose, of course, then he takes over our own kingdom. The devil knew David was to be king. He decided, lion, bear, Goliath. But one by one, they fell. That's why when finally Goliath hit the ground, and David took the sword of the giant to cut off his head, the Bible said a whole nation shouted for joy. I prophesied to someone here today, very soon, when you share your testimony, the whole congregation will shout for joy. I can give you other examples. You remember when the children of Israel were going to the promised land and they got to the Red Sea. Red Sea blocked the way to their destiny. And the enemy was coming from behind to take them back into bondage. But the Almighty God did something wonderful. He broke apart the Red Sea. They were able to walk through to the promised land, the other side. And the Bible said in Exodus 15, verse 1 to all the way to 21, Exodus 15 from verse 1 to 21, that they sang a very special song. They were so full of joy, they danced, they sang. And the Bible recorded for us that in heaven, the song they sang that day will be sung by those who make it to heaven. Revelation chapter 15 verse 3. Revelation 15 verse 3 says, when we get to heaven, the song that those people sang that day, called the song of Moses, we'll be there to sing the song. And I will see you in heaven singing the song. Many of us, when you go to university and you finish your education, you don't rejoice with exceeding great joy because you didn't really have any obstructions. By the grace of God, your parents are able to pay your school fees. Everything went smoothly. Some of you had some little problems. People like me, you took the special grace of God to be able to struggle through. And I'll give you just one example of somebody who reaches goal after passing through fire. Two men quarreled in a village somewhere in Ondo State. And one of the men said to the other, by the time I finish with you, nobody will even remember you came to this world. The other man said, what's wrong with him? He's only angry, speaking in anger. He didn't know the kind of person he was fighting. A couple of weeks later, the man died. When that man died, his children came home to bury him. The number one child in the family, who happens to be a boy, has just returned from Germany in a new car. After they finished burying their father and they were going back, the motor had an accident. The young man who had just returned from abroad died. They brought his dead body home. The mother, who is still sorrowing over the loss of her husband, saw the prime son dead, collapsed, and died. The other children came home to bury their mother. On their way back, another accident happened. The eldest one among the girls died, and so on and so forth, until finally it remains only one boy. And this man now said, oh, this one, before I kill him, I will torture him a little. And the young boy happened to be a medical student. at UI. So the boy, after burying the last of the relatives, came back to campus and suddenly began to tear his clothes, tear his books, and burn all of them. So they took him to Arrow, popping full of drugs. When he was a bit normal, he went back home to go and see if he could get some money to buy the books and clothes again to continue with the study. That man saw him and said, this fellow is still normal. So, you know what they do. Thank God for Jesus Christ. So the boy kept going in and out of Arrow. Until one day somebody said, this case is not a medical case. This is something spiritual. Tell your neighbor, thank God I have Jesus. So they brought him to us in the camp. When they brought him here, if you look at his eyes, they were crimson red. He had not slept for days. Anyway, we prayed a simple prayer. The Almighty God set him free. He told the story. We said, well, in that situation, don't go back home yet. God will provide sponsorship. So he was able to go back to school, finish his education. I remember the day he came to me at the office in the Butemeta after graduating. That day I knew the meaning of exceeding great joy. Stand on your feet. Join hands together and say, Father, every obstacle between me and my goal and that of my neighbor, destroy tonight. Destroy. 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 Destroy every obstacle between me and my goal, every obstacle between my neighbor and his or her goal, destroy tonight. I must reach my goal. 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 Thank you, my Father. Every obstruction between me and my goal, Father, destroy today. Every obstruction between my neighbor and his or her goal, Father, destroy tonight. Destroy tonight. So that we can have exceeding great joy. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. And so shall it be in Jesus' name. Please help me prophesy to your neighbor and say, you shall reach your goal. Yes, you shall reach your goal. In Jesus' name. Then there is what the Bible calls joy unspeakable. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. And according to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 to 8, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 to 8, this is the joy of having Christ. If you have Christ, then, according to the word of God, you qualify for joy unspeakable and full of glory. Because according to Romans chapter 8, verse 31 to 32. Thank you, Father. The Lord asked me to tell you a funny story. In any case, tonight is a night of joy. And God is going to make somebody laugh. It's a story some of you have heard before, but tonight is coming with a very powerful prophecy. I had an uncle. He's gone to be with the Lord now. He loved me, I loved him. And I was staying with him in the 1950s. He was a poor man. And he was the one who was supposed to be feeding me. But there was this particular day, he had nothing. And if the one is to feed you has nothing, what does that mean to you, concerning you? You have nothing too. So both of us sat down there, terribly hungry, not knowing where any food will come from. When all of a sudden, a girl came in carrying a bowl of pounded yam and a stew with chicken. I said to my uncle, my sister said I should go and give you this food. My uncle said, your sister? The girl said, yes. My uncle said, I don't know your sister. And the girl said, well, my sister knows you. And said, I should go and give you this. Okay. My uncle said, okay. I have nothing now, but as soon as I have something, I will come and give you a gift. So the girl left. As soon as the girl left, we descended on the pounded yam and the chicken. We were just breaking the bones of the chicken when the girl came back. I said, I'm sorry I made a mistake. I came to the wrong house. The Lord asked me to tell somebody here tonight. He said, just to show you that I'm the sovereign God, that I do what I like, the blessing that is not your own will be deposited in your house. Thank you, my Lord. In Romans chapter 8, verse 31 to 32, Romans 8, 31 to 32, the Bible says, if God is for us, who can be against us? That means if you have Christ, you have victory. Then he went on to say, the one who had already given you his only begotten Son, what else do you want that you won't get freely with Christ? In other words, if you have Christ, everything you can ever need will be supplied. That's the reason you have exceeding great joy. And for you to fully understand the joy of having Christ, all you need to do is compare the sorrow of a backslider. And I will give you just one illustration and then we'll pray. I went to Zambia. I finished my ministration. And we were coming back to the airport. We were in a car. As we got to the airport, we began to pray. before I say bye-bye to those who brought me. As we were praying, one of the guards at the airport drew near. And he tapped the car to say, we are not supposed to park there. So I lifted up my eyes. I said, we are not parking. We are only praying. And suddenly, he began to cry. I mean, he began to sob. Sir, what is the problem? He said, I used to be a Christian. I used to pray like this. But no more. Stand on your feet. Join hands with your neighbor. Cry to the Almighty God and say, Father, don't let anything take Jesus from me and from my neighbor. Don't let us ever backslide. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty God. Don't let anything steal our joy unspeakable, our joy full of glory. Don't let anything take Jesus from me, Lord. Don't let anything take away my salvation. Don't let me lose Christ. I don't want to lose that joy unspeakable, that joy full of glory, that joy that is only found in Christ. Don't let me lose that joy unspeakable. Don't let me lose Christ. Thank you, Father. Glory be to God. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. So shall it be in Jesus' name. You will never backslide. Let's be seated. Tonight I will take just one more case. And that is full joy. Joy so full you can't add to it. And that is the kind of joy that Jesus Christ said you can have when you ask for it. It is called the joy of answered prayers. There's no joy like the joy of answered prayers. John 16:24. Ask till your joy be full. In 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 1 to 10, 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 1 to 10, Hannah, after all the years of being tormented by her adversary, when finally God granted her request, said something in the song that she wrote. He said for her to be able to cope with the joy, God had to enlarge her mouth. There is a joy so great that when you want to express it, God has to enlarge your mouth. Thank you, Father. In recent days, when ministering, I would suddenly hear someone singing. And each time I heard, some marvelous testimonies have followed. You are witness. Tonight I can hear someone singing. And the song, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord with my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness, thy faithfulness. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. Who is the one who is going to do that singing very soon? If you are the one, let me hear you say amen. I'm about to close. But I will share with you one testimony about the kind of joy that you get when God answers your prayers. Some of you have heard this story before too. So why are you telling old stories? Because there are new people who didn't hear this story the first time it was told. This lady came to the office and said, Daddy, I have a problem. What's the problem? She said she was 33 years old and she was still bedwetting. At 33, married, bedwetting. Well, I said, that's a simple problem. We just ask God to give you a new bladder. She said, not so quick, Daddy. He said, her mother, was a bedwetter. All the girls in the family, they all bedwet. All her own daughters, they all bedwetting. So I knew this is not ordinary physical problem. There's a curse on the family. As I was probing, we discovered that the grandmother had a quarrel with somebody who pronounced a curse on her that every girl in the family will bedwet. So I said, no problem. Give your life to Jesus Christ. I have someone who can cancel curses. She gave her life to Jesus. We prayed a simple prayer and she left. The following day she came. She was crying and laughing at the same time. That's a serious kind of joy. I said, which am I going to believe now? You are crying and you are laughing. What's the problem? She said, Daddy, I woke up this morning for the first time in 33 years. My bed was dry. Stand on your feet. Join your hand with your neighbor. And say, Father, tonight, everything my neighbor has been believing you for, all these years, release now. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty God. Everything my neighbor had been believing you for all these years, no matter how long ago, Release it now. Release it now. Whatever my neighbor had been believing you for, it doesn't matter how long. Release tonight. Release tonight. Father, release tonight. Release tonight. Release tonight. Whatever miracle my neighbor has been trusting you for, release tonight. Doesn't matter how long he has been waiting or she has been looking up to you. Release now. Release tonight. Release tonight. You are the God who answers prayers. Release tonight. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. And so shall it be in Jesus' name. Please be seated. I'm closing. The question is, how much joy can you have? According to the text, Jesus Christ said, that depends on you. It depends on how much you ask. Ask till your joy be full. The biggest problem with us Christians is that we don't ask enough. We just pray for 5 minutes. Some of you are already feeling uncomfortable. Why is he asking us to stand up and pray, stand up and pray, stand up and pray? How I wish that we don't have to watch the walk, the clock. I wish I can just set some people loose to just keep on praying. And of course, when we finish, feel free. You see, in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1 to 7. Thank you, Father. The Lord said, there's someone here tonight. He said, nowadays you find it difficult to rejoice because your miracles had not been lasting. He asked me to tell you, from now on, the miracles will last. In 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1 to 7, a widow came to the man of God and said, I'm heavily in debt. My husband is dead. The creditors have come to take my 2 sons into bondage because I don't have the money to pay. The man of God said, what do you have in the house? He said, nothing, just a pot of oil. The man of God said, we can use that one. Go home. Go and borrow empty vessels from your neighbors. Borrow not a few. She went. She got empty vessels. Began to pour out the oil, like the man of God said. And as she kept on pouring, the vessels were filling. As long as there were vessels, the oil kept on flowing. But when she said to the son, bring me yet another vessel, and they said, no more vessel, the oil stayed. How much oil did she get? It was determined by the number of empty vessels she collected. How much joy will you get? It depends on how much you are willing to pray. Ask till your joy be full. I'll tell you one more story, and we leave the rest to tomorrow. And tomorrow will be glorious in Jesus' name. It's also a story you know very well. I was in London. I went to write a Sunday school pamphlet. I finished writing. I couldn't come home yet because the money I had bought only a special ticket that you can't change. I had no money left. And I said to God, Father, fasting for the next 3 days is no problem for me. But I wish I had £50 because there are certain things I would want to buy. You know the story. 5 minutes later, the phone rang. Somebody said, B. I said, there's no B here. He said, is that not a phone number? So. I said, yes. I said, I want to speak to B. I said, there's no B here. He said, I'm sorry. I said, that's okay. God bless you. I said, what do you mean? God bless you. I said, God bless you. He said, you know God? I said, yes. How do you know him? I said, it's my savior. He said, who am I talking to? I said, my name is Adeboye. He said, which Adeboye? I said, Pastor Adeboye. He said, which Pastor Adeboye? I said, of the Redeemed Christian Church of God. Then he began to scream. He began to call his brother, brother, come and listen. Come and listen. Come and hear who I'm talking to. Apparently, the two of them have been talking about me, wishing they could have an opportunity to meet with me. To cut a long story short, they came to where I was staying. We talked. I prayed with them. When they were going, they gave me £50. When they left, as I was going upstairs to my room, to the bedroom, I said to God, if I had known that you would give me £50 so quickly through a wrong telephone number, I would have asked for 100. I got to the bedroom. As I was settling down, the doorbell rang. And as I was going down, it rang again. I said, I'm coming. By the time I got there, whoever was there had left. But the fellow had pushed through an envelope into the room. I took the envelope. I looked at the back. I recognized the writing. It was the handwriting of a friend of mine who is stinkingly rich, but is the number one miser of the world. He had never given me a dime before. He wrote at the back of the envelope, I feel like giving you some money. I opened the envelope, £50. Ah. On my way back, I said, God, if I had known that another 50 would come so easily, I would have asked for 150. To cut a long story short, another £50 came. Then I became afraid. I said, God, I'm just joking. £50 would have been enough. I've told you the story before. Years later, God spoke to me and said, son, instead of asking me for £50, if you had asked for 5,000, I would have given it to you. You are where you are today because you won't pray. Because you limit the Almighty, the all-sufficient God. Because you keep on asking him for little, little things. You keep on asking for little, little things. Because the Almighty God brought you here this time round so that your joy may be full. Your prayer life will change from today onward in Jesus' name. I want to close, but the Spirit of God is saying, help them. So I'm going to tell you one more story. Again, you've heard it. I'll tell you because it will help some of you. I heard. I wasn't there, but I heard that there was a man in Lagos once who was the richest man in Lagos in the olden days. In the 1950s, very, very rich man. I don't want to mention names. But he said when a relative goes to him to ask him for money, he will say, I work for my own. Go and work for your own. He won't give. But he loved little children. And so if a little child goes to him and asks for anything, the little child will get it. So the relatives began to use that method. Anytime they are going to him, they will take a little child along. They won't ask him for anything, but he will ask the child, what do you want? So one day, a woman took a little girl with her. I said, when uncle asks you what you want, tell him, I want car, I want land, I want houses. If you ask him, I will give you cookies. The woman said, you understand? The girl said, yes, I understand. Okay, they got there. The man came as usual. After greeting, hey, my little girl, what do you want? The little girl said, cookies. This rich man who had discovered the trick of his relatives a long time ago, he knew they were playing games with him, but he didn't mind. He had more money than he could spend. Pretended he didn't hear. Went into the bedroom to allow the woman to reprogram the girl. And the woman said, hey, I'm the one who will give you cookies. Ask the man for land, car, house. I'm the one who will give you cookies. You understand? The girl said, yes. So the man came out knowing that, okay, the woman had done the job now. I said, hey, my girl, what do you say you want? The girl said, cookies. Many of you here, what have you been asking God for? Cookies, that's right. You've been asking the one who made heaven and earth. The one who says, silver is mine, gold is mine, the earth is mine, and the fullness thereof. You go to him and ask for cookies. The one who can release to you a whole nation. The one who can make you a lender to nations. When you go to him, what do you ask for? Cookies. The one who can turn you to somebody whose shadow will heal the sick. When you go to him, you ask for cookies. You only ask for little things for yourself. Just me, my family, my children, my boy and my girl, that's all. Your prayer life will change now. When it is time to pray, you are not going to ask God for cookies. But before we pray that final prayer, there's only one prayer he answers from a sinner. It is God be merciful unto me. So if you are here and you have not yet given your life to Jesus Christ, there's one prayer you must pray before we pray the closing prayer. It's, Jesus, have mercy on me, save my soul, forgive my sins. That is the prayer that you must pray first before we pray the final prayer. So if you are here and you have not yet surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, you better begin to run. Now, I know the crowd is much tonight, and so I'm going to count from 1 to 15. I know some of you will be coming from almost a kilometer away, but you will have to run. And you know, like the testimony we heard, even while you are running, you will be getting your miracles. So, if you want to give your life to Jesus, begin to come now. I'm counting 1. Two. Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. Eight. Nine. Ten. Eleven. Twelve. Thirteen. 14. 15. Okay, those of you who are already in front, begin to talk to Jesus Christ. Just say, please have mercy on me. Save my soul. Wash away my sins. Anything that can stand between me and answered prayers, put it under your blood. Lord, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me. Save my soul today, and I will serve you for the rest of my life. You'll be my Lord. Just save my soul today, and I will obey you from this moment onward. Those of you on the way, keep coming. The rest of us, please, let's stretch our hands towards these people, and let's pray for them. Let's intercede for them, that the one who saved our souls will save their own souls also. Pray for them, brethren. Intercede for every one of them. Intercede for them. Those of you on the way, just keep coming. Make sure you get here before I finish praying, and it will be okay. Just keep coming and pray as you come. Ask Jesus to have mercy on you. Ask him to forgive all your sins. Ask him to be your Lord and Savior. Promise him you will serve him from now on. Promise him you will obey him from this moment onward. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Savior, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for these people who have come forward to surrender their lives to you. Father, you promised that whosoever will come to you, you will nowise cast out. They have come to you now, Father. Please receive them in Jesus' name. Be merciful unto them in Jesus' name. Let your blood wash away their sins in Jesus' name. Please save their souls. Write their names in the book of life. And from now on, anytime they call on you, please answer them by fire. And please, Lord, don't let them go back into the world. Let them serve you till the end. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.
You're watching Redemption Way.